Someone's got squeaky belts. All right, everybody, welcome to another episode of Radiorama, where I show you how to work on radios, television, stereos, like this guy from the 1920s through about the 1960s or thereabouts. And we have this Zenith. There's a lot of models, but basically SFD2650. I'm guessing the other ones are probably different configurations. Here is what it says on the very first page of the owner's manual. It says, "There's a world of entertainment and pleasure in your new Zenith stereophonic high-fidelity radio phonograph." The magic phrase in sound reproduction today is stereophonic high fidelity. Amazing. Makes me want to buy it. It looks like whoever had it took real good care of it, because we still have the original paper cardboard thing going over the top of the Cobra-matic record player. Let's see. Still got the needle and the cartridge in it. I don't think it's been, maybe, either it was treated gingerly or I think these are metal, maybe. Yeah, okay, never mind. Usually I'm used to Zenith having chrome-plated plastic and chrome plating will come right off, but these are metal knobs. I've already taken the back off because I wanted to take a look inside. I've worked on one of, not this particular model, but this, I worked on another one of these in a different cabinet, but the same guts. And I took the tubes out to test them because I'm here at the museum, and you know, if any of the tubes are bad, might as well get them here. And I found that two of the 6BQ5 outputs, which were in that square pattern up there, two of those were not even registering. I had one 12AX7 that was out, and the rectifier was very weak. The owner told me that it had kind of quit working sometime a long time ago. It had been repaired in the 80s. It looks like that someone has a bunch of extra tubes here. Test these as well, see if they're any good. Important Zenith tester, whose number appears below, has thoroughly checked and tested your instrument. It's amazing, everything in there survived. So what I want to do is, since I'm here already, and they have a lot of parts, maybe I'll just go ahead and take the amp out. Take it up to the bench, and replace the electrolytics that are in here. I don't think there's much going on in this amp. It's pretty basic. In fact, I remember it being kind of a basic stereo. It's got pretty beefy 12-inch woofers with decent magnets and some electrostatic, well, not electric, got a horn tweeter here. All right, well, I have taken the unit home and installed new old stock tubes. There's one tube I think it's actually used, but it said tested good. So I'm going to bring it up on my Variax slowly to see if we get any sort of life. I'm going to start it out at about 50% because nothing's going to happen below that. I'm listening for, smelling for anything out of the ordinary. I think I'm seeing pilot lights up there. I'm gonna let that sit there for just a minute. You don't want to slam these things on like that. If there's, like, for example, a heavily shorted electrolytic capacitor, you'll know before you bring it up all the way. Also, the caps, if they've been not used in a long time, they're probably sitting here reforming. This tube, that tube looks gassy. Maybe it's just dirt. I don't know. Let's bring it up a little bit more. Mm.
Can't tell if this has actually got any life to it. Now, do you see the pilot light up there?
He's in the top.
I'm not going to leave it on more than that, but it seems like it works okay, and the record player was trying to turn on. Probably got a little gunk built up around the bearings. Oh, sorry, not sleep very well last night. There's some stressful things happening in my life right now, and to be honest, I'm having a hard time focusing and working on this right now, but I think I'd kind of need to do it to get my mind off of things. But we're off to a good start. It's a big power transformer. So now I'm going to take the chassis out and overhaul them, which means recapping, replacing the electrolytics and whatever paper caps might be in there. It looks like the way this is disconnected, we have an output transformer that has markings about where it goes where. All right, so I took the amp out of there. It actually wasn't that difficult. We have, of course, our two output transformers, and I know a lot of the audiophile guys are like, look at them, those like teeny weeny little transformers. But, you know, you got a push-pull 6-speed Q5s. That's probably about, I think in a push-pull configuration, it's about 15 watts per channel. It's not necessarily the wattage. It's also about the efficiency of the speakers. I know everyone says, well, I have a 300-watt sound system in my car. But your speakers might not be that efficient, so it doesn't matter. I took the tubes out so I can turn it upside down. I don't want to crush them. And there's not a whole lot going on because it's just an amplifier. We have 4/10 of a microfarad caps, actually 5 and 1.01 rated microfarad. And then we have these three electrolytics. And let's see, what value are they? It should be written on the side of the can. It's hard to say. 80 at 450, 70 at 450, and 40. And the hump and the square are the two that are the larger values. I remember working on this before, and I remember being annoyed that it required so many capacitors. I don't know if I have enough left. But I'll have to remember triangle is the one that's the 40. I'll write that underneath there. Have to replace that with a bunch of these guys. Looks like I do have enough. So, rated at 450. What do I have here? 400 volts. 450. Maybe I need to go raid the parts bins over on the other side of the garage. But we'll replace all three capacitors within that, and then the four underneath, the 10th of microfarad caps. Won't take that long. It's pretty straightforward. Lots of room in there. It's interesting, I found the original sales receipt. This thing was sold in San Francisco, and so it's been over there across the bridge its whole life, and it just made it to the evil East Bay for the first time of its life. So not only is it an improvement, in my opinion, of weather, but of atmosphere. And I know some people in San Francisco are probably going to shake their fists at me saying that. We picked it up, it was on this massive freaking hill, and I hadn't brought enough bungee cords to hold it down, and the hill was full of potholes, and I thought, this thing's going to fall over on the way down the hill. Luckily, the guy had a whole bunch of bungee cords, so we were able to really strap it down, so it got here safely. Okay, so I've recapped this guy. We see we have the doubled up electrolytics that gives us our close to 100 microfarads. You can go over your microfarad rating. So even though it called for 70 and 80 microfarads, it doesn't matter. Hundreds will be just fine. And since everything is chassis ground here, you can move them around. There's our 40 microfarad cap there. And we've replaced all the paper caps, which are these gooey guys, with these new modern ones. I wanted to point out something that's kind of important. You see this here? That is a cold solder joint, which is causing it to probably arc here, which is subsequently why we're seeing a little bit of that rust. So I'm going to clip this, clean it up, reflow the solder, because you don't want to have a, you know, resistance there that can stress out your power transformer, for example. So once we resolder that, put the tubes back in, and we'll get the tuner chassis out. I don't remember what's involved with the tuner chassis. I think it might have a significant amount of capacitors inside, or not. We'll see. Welcome back to day two, working on the Zenith console, and I got up this morning, and I decided, you know, my shop is starting to look really grungy. So I know it doesn't look like much to you guys, but I spent the whole day, well, not the whole day, the whole morning cleaning this all out and up and everything. I threw away so much shit. I cleaned out my closet in my office, too, because I had like 30 clunker radios in there. I took those back to the museum. And anyway, as seen yesterday, the amplifier unit is overhauled. So now the next piece will be the tuner unit, which is in here. It's this guy here. It's also attached by some sort of cords that need to be disconnected. And then we'll work on the record player, which is going to be mostly mechanical work. Probably scuffing up the friction wheel and adding some lubricant to clean some stuff out. And then it'll be time to clean the cabinet. I'm not sure how far I'm going to get on this guy today. I know I'm whining, but I'm having a hard time right now, so I'm having a hard time concentrating. But I need to do this to get my mind off of things. Okay, well, I've extracted both the record player and the tuner. And when I look at this tuner, it's kind of like reminiscent of some of the larger high-fidelity table sets that Zenith made. They use tons of transformers. This is probably the FM transformer, or an FM section. I'm trying to remember if this has true multiplex stereo for the FM. I can't remember. Maybe. I'll have to look at the manual. Anyway, the underside is where the pain comes in, because look at all that. There is a ton of capacitors in there. I counted 18. And I probably didn't get all of them, but they're all paper caps, and they all need to be replaced. We got this one electrolytic. Obviously, most of the B+, or pretty much all the B+, probably comes from the tuner chassis, not the amp chassis. And these are the mostly the Goodall type caps. Pretty good quality for the time, despite being a paper cap. Got the values written on them. There's a tenth of a microfarad. These are a whole bunch of 0.047 microfarads. These are bumblebee caps. Those are 0.047 microfarads. These guys, they're just as prone to going bad, if not more so than the paper ones, because if they, you know, if you get a scratch on the bakelite or a crack, then it allows moisture, which can't as easily vent out, so they often explode open. Even though it's probably not a lot of voltage on these are probably related to, well, never mind, those are connected to some of the tubes. A lot of these caps probably do things like affect tone control, biasing, and that kind of thing. The rest of them, these disc guys, these ceramic guys, you don't need to worry about replacing those. Those are fine. They only go bad if they're physically damaged or maybe struck by lightning. There's also a whole shit ton of pots in here that need to be cleaned and lubricated so you don't get any crackling and stuff over the, you know, the audio. Thank God none of the strings are broken. This thing has a ton of strings going all over the place for things like the tuning condenser and the tone control indicators up top here on the front. I guess they're not that complicated, but none of them are snapped. It's good. It's all nylon, so that stays good forever. But, you know, this is just going to be a job of going in here one side, 1 liter at a time, with a new cap one side at a time. You know, I'm just going to shotgun the whole thing. We already know it works, so it's just a matter of making sure that we abide by which cap goes where. This is it's a little more complicated. Probably going to take a couple hours, maybe, to do this, but it's Memorial Day week. I got nothing else to do. All right, I'm about a little over halfway done. Got 10 caps replaced. I believe there's 18 in here. This is a whole crap ton of 0047 rated caps. There's six of them here. I believe those are tone control related. They're all going to these two tone control caps on the end. Anyway, I'm using up a lot of my weird caps here. Weird types of caps. I'm running out of the yellow ones. So I'm using up my orange drops and some of my weird little amber colored guys here. They work fine, whatever. These are going to be real fun to get at under this, whatever that is. What is that? I don't know. I think that's the balance control. Shit. Knock those over. All right, so we'll continue chugging along here. Got to replace that electrolytic as well. Then we'll clean the pots. Then it might be time to do the test to make sure the thing still works. Man, good God. Since I'm kind of, I don't know, thinking about a lot of things, I got this done pretty quickly, actually. Took me about maybe an hour and a half, 2 hours. So now that all the caps been replaced, it's time to clean the pots. We'll just add some. I know people are like, you can't use that. WD-40 works great on pots. And there's a chunk of a big chicken in the egg sort of argument that goes on back and forth about whether it works or not. Some guys swear by it. Other people swear that you'll cause Armageddon and World War III all in one. I've never had a problem with it. But you want to squirt the stuff down to the little slots on the side of the pots here. Work it in real well. Start to move a little more gently. Whoa, a little bit too much.
Oh well.
Do this last one here. I know what that is. What does that even turn? Turn something up here. Oh, it's stereo balance. There's a little indicator up here. Alright, well, that's kind of cool. Then we need to do these wafer switches back here. Like I said, this stuff's pretty harmless. It's mostly just kerosene and some other stuff that instantly evaporates. Now we'll turn that up and get all the little bits and pieces. Little clips of wire and stuff out of there. And it's time to lubricate the tuning mechanism. There's a bearing up in the front here. I'm using a product called Tri-Flow. This stuff is used for bicycles. I found it works great on bearings on tuning condensers as well, and just about anything else. Just want to make sure everything's going to move nice and loosey-goosey. It'll feel better for the future owner. Maybe even put a little bit on the control shafts. Actually, I'm going to use something else because when I try to squirt these with that stuff, it gets all over everything. So I'm going to use a little bottle of... I use a sewing machine oil on some of these joints here, or these connections going out of the pots. And just work that back and forth. So it should work its way in by capillary action. It already feels a lot better. As my hand gets in the way. So I'm gonna let that sit and drain for a little bit, get all the stuff I just squirted in there out. I wanna check these pilot lamps, make sure they're good. So I'd try to put this back in there and find that one or more is out, and I have to take it out again. The other thing I'm going to do is, this has a tape player input, and so I'm going to add a audio input cable. It's going to be a 3.5 millimeter jack. I'm going to solder it right here because this is shielded, and this will be far and away from the unit, so we won't get any AC hum over that. And that way, when someone presses the tape or auxiliary input, they can run their phone or a Bluetooth or something else through it. These guys, I usually give people a Bluetooth unit, just
kind of a little bit more of a nice thing to add for kind of a more premium product like this.
All right, well, I want to just show you something because this is kind of important. It's important if you're thinking about taking the glass plate or plastic off to clean behind it to check what's going on with the print. And I'm looking at this 5 right here, and I can tell that the ink is actually starting to detach a little bit from the glass. If I were to take this off and clean it, all that would come off. So it's best just to leave it alone. No one's really going to know the difference anyway once it's back in the cabinet. Like, if you take those off there, you're screwed. So this guy is ready for a test fire. I'm going to hook everything up loosely back in the cabinet. I want to make sure it all works. Oh yeah, I forgot. I got to hook up my stupid stereo cable first, then we'll take it over there. I'm going to have to do or die time. Shotgun the whole thing, so who knows what's going to happen. Let's see, we got it on tape. Got my Bluetooth running through it. Lights, camera, action. Let's see what happens. Presence. That sounds not right. Why is it clipping like that? Let me try it on one of the other selections. Let's see. Okay, this is really fucking strange.
How can we help you?
6 of the South has had a 30.
It's clipping. Let me try adjusting the volume on the Bluetooth. Well, one of my tubes is completely red plating here, so this one right here is gassy. So that's probably fucking up my audio situation. FM, I don't know what it's doing. It's not actually tuning. I'm not sure if it's a mechanical problem or a electronic problem, but it's definitely weird. So color me kind of disappointed. Well, this tube up here is getting no filament. It's a new tube. So I think it's a problem in the amp. I'm not getting filament to that tube. That's throwing everything off. I'm going to stick another tube in there just for the hell of it. I've never seen a new tube go bad like that. But maybe this guy, when it was red plating, fucked that other one up. We'll see. So I think I've got an issue with the socket. I can't film this because it's awkward. But when I measure voltage, my 6 volts going to the tube, it's there. But it's not going to the tube itself. So I'm going to try to resolder these joints, and also maybe see if I can tweeze the contacts. It's pins number 4 and 5. That's my 6.3 volts for the filament. Well, well, well. We have two problems. First of all, there's a kind of a consistent thumping noise in the audio. Second of all, FM is only staying in one station. Did a cursory look underneath to see if there was any weird solder joints or stuff touching. I think the next thing would be, I haven't tested any of the tubes in the tuning unit. We have a 12AU7, and we have a number of tubes associated with FM. If any of those are shorted or gone, that could cause an issue. Again, you know, easiest thing to start with diagnostics is run your tubes before you get too buried deep into it. Well, I found what may or may not be the problem. These two pins coming off of 12AU7, these connections were touching one another. It could be because I was in here, you know, and I moved some shit around. So I'm just going around and I'm checking all my connections. The tubes, they were all just 100% totally fine. There was no issues. I'm not really seeing
anything crazy out of the ordinary here. I mean, what I'm hearing sounds like something that's touching something that should not be touching, because it's killing a lot of stuff and also interfering with the set's reception. I don't have the schematic, of course. I'm just going around making sure that nothing is touching where it shouldn't be. And not seeing anything crazy. Certainly aggravating. I thought I had this thing in the can, but apparently not. Anyway, just for shits and giggles, I'm going to put it back in. See what happens. Okay, that was the problem with the tuner. Because now the tuner's working great.
844-999. Prize.
That's with no antenna. Now, I'm not sure why my audio input's not working. I'm curious. Perhaps, I don't know, it's very strange. I'll show you what it's doing. That's tape. Yeah, hear that? It only does it a certain volume. Now, I'm wondering if what they're doing is they're... I'm going to do an experiment here. I think I have an idea. Okay, running in through the phono connection works just fine. I can't figure out why the other one wouldn't work. The only thing I can figure out is going through some very small resistors or capacitors. I'm wondering if I bypass those and go directly to the input, would that solve the issue? Those are probably cutting shit down. That's actually coming off of... I'm talking out loud to myself. Let's see. Yeah, might as well give it a whirl. But the good news is I think I've solved both of my weird problems. Alright. Probably YouTube will get the copyright claim on that, but whatever. That worked. I just bypassed those two capacitors. I've got a little bit of hum here. I think what I need to do is get some shielded cable or something. Either that or see about turning the cable around. Good news is electrically we're in pretty good shape here. In fact, it's 3 o'clock. Potentially gonna go pick up some cats today. I'm gonna adopt some cats. So I think I might ease off the electronics for the day, maybe start working on the cabinet. It's pretty grubby. I'm just glad that I got all the electronic crap figured out. I was kind of worried there for a minute. All right, let's just resume with the next day of working on the Zenith console. And as a review of what all happened yesterday, the tuner chassis was recapped, but then initially had a problem with this tube red plating and this tube refusing to get filament. I had one of the pins on the tube socket was kind of bent, so I bent that back. That fixed that problem. And then we had a problem in the tuner chassis. It was making a thump, thump, thump noise. There was two pins that were on 12AU7 that were contacting each other, and that was causing a short. And we also had an issue with the audio input not going in properly, as well as FM out. Fixing the short on the 12AU7 solved the FM receiving issue. And I've gotten the audio in fixed. It is humming a little bit. So I'm going to do an experiment. I think if maybe I reverse the plug, because I have a polarized plug on this, that'll solve that humming issue. What I might just do is just grind off the
these nubs here, and then I can flip it either way. And depending on what that wiring situation is in someone's house, they can flip it either or to reduce that hum a little bit. The next thing I need to do is work on the record player, which, as I stated before, is not turning, even though it acted like it wanted to turn. That means one of several things. Either the bearings on the motor are seized up a little bit, need to be freed up with some lube, or we have a friction wheel that is either dried out or has slicked over from use and needs to be cleaned up and scuffed up a little bit. So let's go ahead and take this record player apart. The way that you do it is I'm going to remove this C clip, put it up here for safekeeping, and then we'll lift this platter off, and underneath we should see the friction wheel, the motor, all that good stuff. All right, with the platter removed, I can do a few initial looky-loos in here. I'm feeling the rubber on the, that sounds dirty, on the friction wheel. It's still pretty flexible. And the motor's a little stiff. It could be oiled up a little bit. The rubber motor mounts are in pretty good shape. Let's see what happens when I take it over to 33. What does that hit? Okay, we're well within the spec because the only other setting is 16, which would be up here. And you can see that turret there. It's landing where it should be going. So we're good in shape there. Let's take a look at the mech. This is a voice of music changer. Very common. And one of our more recent members showed me a few things about these. And something that tends to really get gunked up on these guys is there is a little bearing that's located on this cog here. Forget where it is. Let's try to loosen up the tone arm here. See if we can turn this around. These two guys, these bearings need to actually turn and swivel, and they're pretty hard to turn. That's a problem. Let's see. Again, we need to lubricate the bottom and the top of the bearings of the motor. And I'm going to take the friction wheel off and clean it in the sink and also scuff it up with some sandpaper. And where you put the lube for the bearings is, see where that brass area is? You just drip a little in there with a little zoom spout. We can take that cog off. And if I'm not mistaken, you can take this whole piece off with just loosening that, and this guy in the center. All right, so now I'm going to proceed to clean the entire mech. Turns out the bearing that I was referring to is actually on the outside versus the inside, so that makes it easier. So I'm going to do is soak it in carburetor cleaner. Well, apparently that can is out, so I'll use my second can. Good old B1 Chem tool. So it's been around for a million billion years. All I'm doing here is loosening up all the old grease and everything that's accumulated in there over the years. Something has gone screwy here. Let me put this down. I can't film and do this at the same time. All right, well, it was just really solidly gunked up. It's moving a lot more freely now. The last thing I'm going to do, this is an experiment. I'm going to use this stuff I've been using in my cars for a long time. It's called Seafoam. It's a product that's used to de-gunkify drivetrains and valve trains on old cars like my Mercury. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to soak it in here. And generally what you want to let it do is sit there for about, oh, I don't know, 10 or 15 minutes. I can just hear the record player, guys. Yeah, see that? It just melts the shit off of there. So, I'm just going to get it into contact with everything. And it'll eventually dissolve all that stuff. I'll let it drip out there. I think while I'm waiting for this to drain, I'll meander my way over to the cabinet because it needs to be cleaned up. That's dirty.
This is mostly like some sort of plastic veneer type of stuff. I think on the top, the front is, I don't know what this is, some sort of pickled wood. It's referred to as the Italian style. Don't ask me why they called it that. It certainly doesn't look Italian to me. And I'm sure if there's any Italians watching this, they're like turning up their noses. But I'm going to go over it with a little mixture of Simple Green cleaner and some rags to try to bring back, you know, clean some of the accumulated grime off. All right, well, that cleaned it pretty well. I'm not sure if you can tell the difference, but I can. It smells like, well, not smells like, there's a lot of cigarette nicotine on it, and so now everything is a lot more cleaned up. Again, I'm kind of like, I don't know about that cabinet. Meanwhile, this guy over here, after letting it sit for a while, that stuff, that seafoam worked really well. This now turns real smooth. I mean, it's just like as smooth as can be, and I'm not done yet. I'll add a little bit of lubricant to that mech, and then I'll clean the top up here. Probably do a reassembly, and then we'll do a power up to see if it's actually working. All right, so we got this all cleaned up and lubricated. Now what's left is to put these bearings back in and oil it up, and we'll give it a spin, see if it works. I'll tell you what, I'm annoyed. For some reason, this output tube decided to stop showing a filament. Ow, Jesus! Burnt myself on that thing. I'm tired of taking this thing in and out of there, so what I'm going to try to do... I know it's pins number 4 and 5. 1, 2, 4, 5. I'm trying to crimp those connections just like I did in the other one with my little pick here. I can't film doing this because I'm inside the console, but you get the idea. So basically, from my right, where that gap is, 1, 2, 3, you're going to crimp 4 and 5 pins back together. Well, that did it. We got the filament back. I had to re-crimp pins 4 and 5 over in that tube, so now we got filament. The issue I'm having now, everything seems to work okay, but I'm getting a lot of AC hum. I think it's coming from this unshielded cable. Doesn't do it on radio. Kind of does it on record player, but I think it's because those two connections are semi in the same area of the chassis. So I'm not sure if I have any shielded cable. I'm gonna need some. It seems like everything else is working all right.
Man who's got a commercial.
Mike Epps coming to the Mountain Winery Wednesday, July.
Seems like it's pretty sensitive. Got a little bit of a crackling on that selection there. Sometimes you have to work the controls a whole bunch, even though I oiled and cleaned the crap out of it. I haven't tested the record player yet, actually. I wonder if it actually works. Sure sounds like it. Let me get a record, put it on there. Seems to be working pretty good on the record player. Actually, you know what? It's doing that same thing again. Now I have to crank it almost all the way up. Shit. Fucking hell, man. Well, there's still something in there. It's causing something to mess up. Well, anyway, back to the drawing board. Got to take this out here and look for more touch and connections. This is a weird scenario where I cannot figure out what's causing this strange issue. At first, it seemed like maybe it was a tube issue because it was only doing it after it warmed up. But it only does on record player. It doesn't do it on radio. So I'm wondering maybe if the cartridge or the needle is starting to go out. I actually have a spare cartridge and needle right here. I guess it wouldn't hurt to try. I could do it right here. Sure. Well, I just got off the phone with one of the museum guys. I think I found the problem. It's a weird problem. We figured it was probably mechanical. And he told me maybe do a few things, like put my hand and stabilize the turntable because it's floating. And what I can feel here is that it's definitely kind of vibrating a little much. I'm wondering if maybe the bearings just need to continue seating a little bit better. Might put a little more oil down in some of the main bearings here. But anyway, it just needs to smooth out. Could just be after I oil it. I'll let it spin here for a while. I'm pretty much done for the night anyway. And I need to water the plants. It's hot out here. But I'll just leave this running for a while. Let it do its thing. Well, apparently Miss Duck is interested in the stereo. There's your buddy. Anyway, I was talking to one of the members on the museum yesterday because I'm having this strange situation with reverb. I'm not sure if I mentioned this last night. I was kind of out of it. But apparently the booming bass of the speakers can in turn like cause a microphonic effect on the tone arm and the needle. It could also be a microphonic tube, or it could be a microphonic ceramic capacitor. These guys are made out of a piezo material. That could definitely be an issue. The two audio-related tubes on this chassis are the 6T8 and the 12AU7. 6T8's is three-section tubes. There's a little more complexity going on there. So I'm going to replace this guy just for shits and giggles. I might take the tuner chassis out and see if there's any capacitors that are leaning up against something. Maybe I can get them away from the chassis. The other thing I did is I got a shielded cable for the audio over here. So maybe the audio in will not make that noise either. We'll see. In the meantime, it's time to go feed the ducks cat food. All right, so what I've done here is I've tried to make sure that none of these ceramic caps are touching anything else, just in case they are microphonic. There was a few that were leaning up against a few things, but it doesn't seem like they're touching much of anything. There was a few that were leaning up against the chassis. That could definitely make them microphonic. Anyway, I cleaned up the pots a little bit more. I'm going to put it back in the chassis. Back in the cabinet. I also reconnected my audio line going to this shielded connection for my shielded cables to directly plug into. While I'm at it, I'll clean these up. And then we'll shove it back in, see if it makes any improvement. Okay, that made a big difference. There's a little bit of hum, which is to be expected, but it's much quieter now. Probably help if I got this away from there. Seemed to make that big much of a difference. Now, I want to try this record player here. So I have a weird theory. I believe that maybe, I mean, it seems like it's much better, but this thing is vibrating just ever so slightly. And I mean, not much. When you turn it up, I think somehow that is picking up through the pickup arm to the speakers that in turn are kind of doing this number to amplify this. And this thing is not sitting on rubber shock mounts. It's sitting on springs, like hard metal springs. So, I mean, you see how much that's wiggling. It wouldn't take much. Now, the thing is, I remember one of our members sent us a memo from Zenith where they were acknowledging there was kind of a problem
with this cabinet and this record player where essentially the speakers would pick up the ever so slight, well, they'd amplify ever so slight vibrations. And that in turn would cause that to be transmitted back to the tone arm. I know that sounds weird, but it's basically a feedback loop, mechanical and an electrical feedback loop. So I'm doing an experiment here. Turn this down all the way. See, that feels as smooth as can be. I mean, there's a little bit of vibration, but not much. See, I can actually feel the bass of those speakers hitting this. Now, I'm curious if I turn the bass down. Yeah, see, that dissipates. That goes away. See, that's cranked up really loud. But if I guarantee if I start turning up the bass, then this is going to start vibrating from the speakers, and that's going to transmit back feedback through the amplifier. Holy cow. That's totally the problem right there. That is the issue. As such, there's not much I can do about that. I mean, that's just, it's the way it's designed. I mean, the good news is, like, in order for that to happen, you have to crank it up to the point it almost hurts your ears. So it's not likely that whoever gets this is actually going to do that, especially if this is in a garage without the back on, and it's not up against the back. You put this in a sealed room against the wall, the walls are going to do part of the sound amplification. I also seem to don't have a tweeter here, so I'm wondering if maybe, I noticed there's a capacitor going in here, either that or maybe I've got a bad connection. I mean, it's not the end of the world. If it worse comes down to worse, we've got spare horn tweeters at the museum and I can replace that. Let's see. Wait a minute. Anyway, I'll check that out, check for connections, and then check the tweeter itself, see if it's got resistance, what kind of ohms it's got, and if not, then the element could have gone bad. Again, not the end of the world. We've got tons of horn tweeters over there. Okay, so this tweeter horn is actually open. I took one lead off of the other side, and it seemed like it's actually open, completely open, so I tested this other guy. That one's not. So what I'm going to have to do is take this whole thing out, and I'll take it over to the museum and compare. You know, worst comes down to worst, if I don't have anything like that, I can put a regular, maybe like a paper element tweeter. That'll help at least even it out somewhat, but I'd rather have a horn. Those project a lot more. Okay, so sure enough, this horn tweeter is bad. I checked the connections, so tomorrow I'll need to go over and find a replacement. And it says even here, I thought, well, maybe I can unbolt it. I know nothing about tweeters. I thought maybe I could solder whatever's loose. And it says, do not take this apart. You will damage it. So I get a feeling the Zenith engineers weren't stupid, so I'll take them at their word. Well, I've had it playing for about 2 hours, and it seems like it's not having an issue. So I think it's time to turn it off for the night. And tomorrow I'll go look for another tweeter. Install that and see how that works, and then we will maybe call it a project. Who knows? We'll see. All right, well, I'm here at the museum. We're going to go look for speakers. One of the members, since I'm not technically allowed to say the actual museum's name, said maybe you should just make up another name for the museum, like Crazy Uncle Al's or something. Yes, I'm at Crazy Uncle Al's place. Ooh. Oh, those are too big. Oh, they're close. Never mind. Wait a minute. Let me see. Looks like Magnavox tweeters. By Jove, I believe those will work. I mean, there's a pair there. I could just find one that's by itself. And it's not like we're... Oh, a crazy Uncle Al. He sure has a hoarder, isn't he? Let's see. Tweeters, tweeters, tweeters. Any other tweeters? I'll dig around. But I think I have the one I need if I can't find anything else. Okay, so I got back from Crazy Uncle Al's, and this horn tweeter's perfectly going to replace that one. I doubt the sound's going to be that different. It's not like this is made for audio files anyway. So I'll just bolt that sucker in, and then I'll give it another test fire. There'll be time to put the back on. Maybe do a little more cleaning on the top. One of our members is going to redo the veneer here. There's a little bit of damage here. We're going to try to match and replace that front. I mean, it's hard to tell. If it were up to me, it'd be like, so what? But the value of these mid-century consoles has kind of gone up, so it's worth the effort. So I'll let them do it. So I'll put the horn tweeter in there, test it, put the back on. I intend to release this tomorrow. All right, so we have a treble on both channels now, so it sounds a lot better. And what I want is with somebody else, and it's nobody's fault but my own. Everything I had going for me is gone. I didn't know what a good thing. I think it's freaking loud. Not bad. This must have blown the roof off of many a suburban rancher home in the 50s. Anyway, I'm gonna put the back on. I'm gonna do a little more cleaning, and I think this is gonna be the sound system for tonight in the garage, because my brother is gonna come over here and we're going to do the burly things, like have a couple beers, talk about life in general. Anyway, thanks so much for watching. I know this was kind of a crazy, long, drawn-out, ridiculous episode over a console that definitely has kind of love-or-hate-it design. It's kind of like so ridiculous 50s that it's almost good-looking. I don't know. But anyway, even if you don't care how it looks, it actually sounds pretty decent. And I've worked on this particular model, but not this cabinet style before. And I like working on Zenith, in particular as a brand, so when I get a giant Zenith console, 2 tons of fun. Alright guys, thanks so much for watching, and if you have any comments or questions, you can leave them down below. And until next time something comes across my workbench, which I assure you will be coming forward in the shiploads, see you guys next time. Adios.